In particular, I want to focus on the role of common sense, the role of intuition, the role of thinking outside the box, as it is called, in doing science. So even though all of us are doing science, which is very deep, and we get more and more focused, we dig deeper and deeper, somewhere along the way, we may lose a little bit of common sense. So here, like it was said, it's a very informal session. So think about, you know, friends sitting down in a park and talking about things which concern us all. I want to bring out a few examples. Now, some of these examples are from my own experience. It's not that they are earth-shaking, but because I know about them a little bit better, I know what went in there, what came out, and how it all happened. So it's better to illustrate things with your own understanding and example, rather than just borrow abstract things from everywhere. There may be a couple of examples which come from elsewhere as well, because they are very compelling examples and they can be easily understood by any of us regardless of what area we work in. Now, of course, one of the reasons we lose common sense while doing science is starting from our primary school education. While our education or learning, if you would, not just education, but learning as a whole, it's basically, it goes from chapter to chapter, goes from exam to exam, then it goes from course to course, year to year, degree to degree, and basically too much focused at the moment about basically cracking the next exam and moving on. So there is no possibility and there is no reward for synthesis. So we are very good at analysis, but we hardly put together everything that we know, that we ought to know or should have known over the years in order to solve problems. So problem solving is entirely different from merely doing research, right? So we do research because, well, we are professionals in doing research and we have to do certain kind of research that we are trained to do. What I want to bring forth is basically there are many different ways of doing research, especially using common sense. And so there are certain facets of that common sense that I want to share with you. So first thing, well, you know, whatever is called lateral thinking, creativity, or common sense, what do we actually mean by that? Different people mean different things and they understand different things by the same words. Basically, if you think about creativity, there are two different ways you can think about creativity. The first one is, you know, creativity as in somebody like Ramanujan, which is very rare, which is very exceptional. And you would get that in one out of a million or 10 million people, right? So this is something that, you know, you just say, oh, how is that possible? How can you dream up this, you know, very complex series going to infinity and say this equals under root pi or whatever, right? There is no obvious way to actually arrive at that conclusion. And that is a creativity of different order. Now, what we understand in the modern context about what creativity means, basically, I did a lot of thinking about it. I say, how can I be creative? What does it mean, actually, to be creative? Basically, I come up with this hypothesis that creativity in the modern way of doing science, or for that matter, doing anything, social science, political science, what have you, is basically there is a whole lot of knowledge which is fragmented out there. You know, this is in silos, this is what everybody knows, but we all of us know a little part of it. Now, these are the dots of knowledge. If you create connections between these dots, especially those dots which have not been connected before, especially those dots which are very far from each other, where you see no obvious connection. So, you know, you started with biology, you started with physics, and somebody made biophysics out of it, or biochemistry. But now to do that anymore is not creative. Okay, that is a done deal, that's a told story. Now, if one started looking at these domains of knowledge, which have not found actually working principles together, right? And if we can come up with those, then that is what I would call creativity of some order. At least zero order, and most of us are actually involved in that kind of creativity, and hope that, well, if I can relate this aspect of social science to what I know in physics in order to enrich both the domains, right? Then I have created something new. And this is how I look at what most of us actually would do as scientists. Of course, one way we would do, we continue to flourish as scientists is to be confined to my PhD area. And unfortunately, a whole lot of us actually keep doing that. But these are rates of marginal return. So after 10 years, what really is going to happen in that case is that before you start your work, you would have seen the end of it. So in your dream, you would see what you would come out of this research. You would also see what graphs you would show, generally what they are going to look like, what journal you would publish them in, and so on. So by that time, actually, creativity and fun has really gone out of science. This is a time to take a hard look and say, look, is there something new, something creative that I could do? I'll give you an example about common sense first. So here, this is a problem that I gave an open book exam. All my exams are open book, and now people can also connect to internet or whatever, doesn't really matter, because we never solve problems by closed book in real life, right? So it's completely wrong to say, now you should remember all these formulae and so on, then I'm only testing your memory, right? So what we want to test is problem solving skills. We also want to test actually, can one understand the content of that problem and relate it to what we know? And we should also know which book I'm going to find it in and whether I'm going to find this at all. Now this problem, well, basically what you're looking at here is a solid shell, so it's like a hollow ball. You fill a fluid at temperature T2 inside and you put it in a bath of liquid at temperature T1. And you ask people, what would be the steady state temperature profile across the shell? In other words, how the temperature is going to change coming from T1 going to T2, right? Now, this is a classical problem in the second chapter of any book in heat transfer. It shows the same sketch and it gives the solution to this problem, which is Laplacian of temperature equal to zero. You solve it in spherical polar coordinates, then you would get the answer for this, which is given there. So now what do people look with open book exam? They look at this sketch, and there's a sketch like this in the book, and there's a solution to this problem in the book. It even gives the same temperatures T1, T2, R1, R2. So it's, you know, they say, okay, Eureka, problem solved. So you write down the solution from the book. But if you think about it, while you fill a fluid at temperature T2 in a ball, put it in a bath of liquid T1, eventually temperatures would be the same inside and out, and the temperature, well, would be T1 if the bath is rather big, isn't it? So now, when I told this problem to my wife, who is a political scientist, she could solve this problem. However, the people doing my course, about 65% of them could not solve this problem. Believe me, I mean, I'm not kidding here. And then I repeated the same problem after 25 years in the same course. Right now, the proportion this time had gone up to 75% people who could not solve this problem, right? Or maybe first time around it was 60% or so, but certainly the proportion had gone up. So it's a controlled experiment. It's the same instructor who has gotten a little bit wiser after 25 years of teaching. It's the same book and same problem, right? So what goes wrong here? I mean, what goes wrong is our shortcuts in education. So we have been led to believe that, well, if I, you know, if everything looks the same, it's a pattern recognition problem, basically, right? Then the solution is also the same. So therefore, it's just a cautionary tale, and it's rather disappointing tale that we forget all the common sense there is. In fact, I guarantee you, if you properly pose this question to a kid in class 5, it's more likely, the odds are better than, you know, better than 70% that he or she would be able to answer it, right? So this says something about how we think and how we solve problems. Okay, I'll quickly tell about two examples which tell us something about the different ways of doing science and also about connecting dots. So the first example is the story of scanning, tunneling, microscopy, and atomic force microscopy, AFM is called. And you would notice that one of these inventions that got fastest Nobel Prize in science, physics, right? So now, what does AFM do? I set up only the second AFM in the country nearly 20 years ago. And very fascinating story. Anyway, all the stuff that we have been able to see with it. What is AFM? Well, AFM is this atomic force microscope. What it does is got a small stick, a cantilever. It goes across the surface and is able to sense the bumps and valleys and hills on very small scale on the surface. So it's surface imaging, right? With a resolution on a good day, you don't, you know, vibrate it too much or whatever, and you know, don't yell and shout, don't get too frustrated, then the resolution would be, well, could be even a nanometer or something like that, right? So how does it work? I mean, it's very simple. When we think about imaging something, we think about radiation, we think about light, and say this is the only way to see. I mean, we most of us start with that assumption that to see is to see through light. But in this particular case, it's a mechanical way of seeing. Now, if you think about how does a blind person see, well, you take a stick, you tap it on the surface. As you go along, you drag it across the surface. Close your eyes, you can make a map of actually seeing, a seeing map of what you are touching. So basically, if you translate that concept of seeing or generalized seeing into technology, then you get AFM. So you have a little cantilever there, right? You tap on the surface, keep the pressure to be the same, and then drag it across the surface. As you go up and down with the surface, you convert that into a map, right? Of course, a very small stick, right? Fragile, because you want to, you know, see small things. And with a small bending of the cantilever, right? So there you are. Now, basically, what you want to illustrate with this is that one needs to generalize the concept of anything that we say or do or see. There are many different ways of seeing, and all of them can be converted to a technology, to an equipment, and that basically, you know, enriches what we can do. The whole development of nanotechnology is based on, well, STM, AFM. It's not that there was no nanotechnology before these instruments, but you know, whatever you made, you could not see them. And so seeing is believing, and therefore, well, technology is very intimately related to science. Or, you know, how much science you can actually do in a meaningful way also depends on technology. It's a co-arising of science and technology from the oldest days of industrial revolution. Okay, the second example that illustrates that, look, when we start some work, we are very strongly focused on an objective. So what happens that on the way, if we encounter something new, something interesting, something important, then we tend to discard it. You say, look, I'm not really looking for this, you know, and that happens more often than we believe, right? So here is an example, which is another Nobel Prize, which is the story of graphene. Graphene, as we know, is a two-dimensional sheet of carbon atoms, right? So it's just one, you know, it's just a plane, and all the carbon atoms are in the same plane, and it's a material, a magic material, which is found to have enormous number of applications, as well as doing fantastic two-dimensional science, right? Science of surfaces, for example. So now, how did this person, Andre Geim, etc., well, how did they get the first layer of graphene that you could work with, right? So it's very simple. You take a block of graphite. Now, as we know, that graphite is made up of many different layers of graphene-like material, but the bonding between these layers is very weak. So out-of-plane bonding is weak. So what people do is you put a you know, a piece of tape on the surface of graphitic block and then peel the tape, right? So now, because of the weak cohesion between these two-dimensional layers, some of these graphene layers are going to stick to the tape and pull off with the tape. Then you can transfer it from the tape to some other substrate, right? So it's very simple. And so, well, again, you do it 10 times, it's not that simple, then you hope to get some little flake of graphene. But what is the interesting point about this story? The interesting point is not that you can actually get a layer of graphene by using a tape on a graphitic block, but the fact that the same procedure was being done by many different scientific groups for many decades before they got graphene by this method. So what was going wrong? Well, basically, people were using this method to clean the surface of graphitic block. They were not interested in what was sticking to the tape. So they throw away the tape and keep the block. In this case, you throw away the block and keep the tape, right? So it all depends on where you focus is very important. So anything that comes along while we do some study can be equally important. We just have to know its worth. A lot of things happen in science by serendipity, which means you did not plan for it. It just happened to have, you know, something happened. And if we happen to catch it at the right moment with the right intent, understanding the value of it, then indeed it would turn into something good. I'll give you an example from my lab. So basically, to illustrate the fact, this serendipity can be a powerful tool in science, but only if we let it. I mean, if we just throw it away, we say, no, this is not my objective. I am not going to look at it. My boss said, my sir said, do this experiment and get me these readings. Okay, don't bother me for nothing else, right? If we do that, you're going to miss out a whole lot of richness of that experiment. So by the way, a lot of people come, you know, I do the same. I say, they come, to me and say, sir, this experiment is not working. First, I tell them, don't call me sir. Then they say, yes, sir. So I let it go at that. Now, beyond that, I try to tell them there is no such thing as a failed experiment. You know, experiment is a fact. This is what happens. There is no such thing as a failed experiment. There is such a thing as failed theory. We should not push theory beyond a certain point. It is usually a hypothesis in any case. And we should try to falsify it rather than try to prove it in 20 different ways. So when we try to prove something which, you know, most people believe in anyways, then this work is very incremental. So what distinguishes an incremental work from profound work is basically we are again trying to repeat the same thing and prove it in 20 different ways, when really nobody is questioning it, right? So you say, okay, well, I have also done it. And I say, oh, this group in MIT, Harvard has worked on it 5 years ago, and I can also do it with a little twist, right? So that's not really that, you know, important to actually do this. It's more important to go about looking for weaknesses rather than strengths, right? So anyway, here, what we were trying to do is this. You know, the shark skin, it remains gleaming smooth and really not get fouled up by marine fouling, whatever, and partly is because of the microstructure on the surface of the shark skin. So it is a microstructure which is very sharp and, you know, really is pretty scary, right? So nobody gets a foothold on this skin, and we wanted to replicate this kind of structure in the lab to understand the fouling properties of this surface. So to do that is rather simple. You take a block of polymer and then use a stamp that has negative replica of what you want to make. And then with a lot of pressure and some temperature, you transfer the stamp features on this polymer block, right? So it's called, well, some kind of imprint lithography or whatever. So here you do that. Then you produce this structure, right, which is a pyramidal repeat units, which look like this. You can do it over a centimeter squared area or in larger areas, and you can do it very quickly and painlessly if you have this stamping tool sitting in your lab, right? So this is what we did. So we can replicate structures like that. Then the next thing was, well, that, you know, to stabilize these structures, well, you heat them and then cool them to bring it to room temperature. So when you do that, you see that this pyramid, it splits right in the middle. So you open a channel there from the top it goes to bottom, and it has really split this triangular structure in two parts and created a channel there, which is a nano channel. Now, this is what was happening with the student who was doing this work for nearly 4 months, and he has been throwing away all these samples because he was not able to stabilize the structure which happens on the shark skin, right? And the goal of this project was to replicate that structure. So he kept saying, ah, this sample is destroyed, and he threw it away in the dustbin, right? And well, he got very frustrated, and he said, no matter how many samples I make, they all get split like this. So what do I do now? So I got very excited. He said, but you know, this structure is even more difficult to make than the structure that you wanted to create in the first place. Not only is it more difficult to create because you are creating billions of nano channels regularly organized on a surface, but you are doing that without using any machine tool, right? You are not using an ion beam or you know, electron beam or what have you, right? You are able to do it by self-organization, right? Self-organization is something that happens by itself, and you don't need a machine tool to do it. Like, you know, this living science is a self-organized group. People stick together because they see some value in this. You lower your energy and then you make this group, right? Or this thing happen here. So the thing was, we could use these structures, for example, for other purposes, for doing nanofluidics, for stretching out DNA molecules in these channels, right? But unless, you know, we had recognized the value of this happening, right, we would actually not would have done something trivial that any lab anywhere can do anyways, right, by having the same tool. Now, anyway, to complete this story, I'll tell you why this happens. So when you make a pyramidal structure like this by stamping at high pressure, there is a lot of deformation of polymer. So stresses build up at sharp corners, right? Whenever you do that, we all know, sharper the corner, more stresses is going to suffer. So when the structure relaxes, there's a crack that starts right at the top at the sharp corner and then propagates down and splits the structure in the middle. So anyway, one can also generalize this, because now you see, based on this, you can make all kind of sharp structures on micro scale and go about splitting them by itself, and then you can create more complex structures by doing this little engineering. I want to give you an example going back all the way to 1988. This is the time I was completing my PhD, and I had interest in, well, I was doing PhD on very thin liquid films, let's say a film which may be 10 nanometer across. I was completing a PhD in looking at the behavior of very thin liquid film on a surface, and such films are unstable. I will show you actually what happens, and they de-wet the surface, right? Now, I came across, while going in the library, a conference on what is called dry ice at that time. Dry ice, then I looked up, seemed interesting to me, and then I looked up some more stuff on it. It said, well, dry ice happen when the tear film that covers the cornea becomes unstable and breaks up on the surface, so that corneal surface is exposed to ambient, to outside, so that bacteria can get access, injuries can happen, keratinization of corneal epithelial cells happen, all kind of nasty things happen, right? So then, well, I said, but of course I know about the behavior of liquid films on surfaces, so I can look at this problem. This doesn't seem to be a big issue. Of course, biology is always more complex, especially in the living organisms. And so this was a very rich experience. I did a lot of work. I learned surgery on rabbits. I also became an adjunct faculty in medical school to do this kind of work. So from there, I heard some talk at that time, stem cells were very hot. Right now they are very commonplace, but back in 85 and stuff, people were talking about this new thing called stem cells, and they say, well, this is the key to understand everything, right? So I, by that time, I had enough experience with cornea, and I said, let's look at, is there such a thing as corneal stem cells, right? And if there are, as you know, I mean, as opposed to, let's say, general stem cells for anything, are there specialized, localized corneal stem cells. Now, one of the reasons for that is cornea has no blood supply. So, all the cells that are then corneal epithelium, I'm talking about epithelium actually, outside layer, outer layer of cornea, whether these cells are being generated somewhere and migrating here. So, there were only a couple of studies related to this problem at that time. And what I want to illustrate is that based on my background, which was in engineering, I could look at this problem in an entirely different way. So, a biologist would not look at this problem in this way ever. I mean, even if we had 10 lifetimes, he'll just not understand this viewpoint at all. So, what is it? See, so we, you know, as chemical engineers, undergraduate courses, we all know how to do mass balance or to do heat balance. It basically says, you see, what comes in plus what is generated is what goes out. It's very simple, right? There is nothing more that ever happens anywhere, whether in biology or otherwise, right? So, all we did, I go about setting up a mass balance for the cornea. Cornea is over there. It looks like this, deeper layer cells that divide, proliferate, move up and shed in the tear film, right? Now, if you do a mass balance on cornea, you see there is a deficit of cells there. So, we could do experiments on what is the rate of proliferation, what is the rate of death, and then if you do that, you see that there is some missing mass, right? Which first of all tells you that mass is coming from somewhere else, that the cornea itself is not, cannot sustain its mass. Okay, that's the first conclusion. Then you say, well, where is this coming from? So, it's very simple. What you do is, you take these circles around the cornea, okay, take more and more of cornea in this circle and then do mass balance within the circle. Now, for a particular radius of this circle, mass balance would be satisfied. Okay, but if you take a small circle, small diameter circle, then you have less number of cells being produced than those that are dying. So, we could isolate the fact that the stem cells for the cornea are coming from the periphery of the cornea, which is called the limbal region. This in fact is very simple, and then of course you could prove it experimentally, but whatever is proved mathematically is pakka. You cannot doubt it, right? I mean, you cannot have not mass conservation. It took me nearly 2 years to explain this to clinicians. Biologist, I could explain in 2 months, right? But anyway, there's another story. This is about, you know, perils of doing interdisciplinary research. Anyway, it did get published in a good journal of the area, and it has an interesting implication. Now, implication is that you see when you do corneal grafting, right, the donor corneas. So, if you take only the central portion of the cornea in grafting, then you would not have the stem cells included in there. Since then, the practice of corneal transplant has undergone a lot of changes. So, now it is preferred that you have a full radius corneal graft. It's got better chances of survival, right? So, a very simple, interesting example wherein you say, look, we should not keep repeat doing whatever else is doing, what 10,000 other people are doing that they are already good at doing. I should bring my own unique insight and expertise in every problem that you look at. This is a way to connect different domains of knowledge that have not been connected before. Another point that I want to quickly cover, actually each of these points is worth a full semester course. But we are going to go through this very, very quickly just to introduce some key concepts and ideas, right? And maybe with half an example or something like that. So, you know, I have often thought about the fact that you see quantum mechanics and general theory of relativity are known for more than 100 years, right? But what makes actually leaves like lotus leaf water repellent is known only for 15 years. So, there is something strange going on in science. What is that strange going on? Well, most of us, we like to sit in our office. Earlier, in the library, we used to look at books. We talk to people. Now, we stare at the laptop, internet, whatever. But, you know, even if we pass through nature, we just don't think there is anything interesting or important happening there. We take it for granted, right? We say, hey, this is all understood. Even if it's not understood by me, there must be somebody out there who understands it, right? Anyway, it can't be of very great significance, right? But most of the important, interesting technologies that happen, they do not happen in lab. They happen in nature. So, you know, because it's completely excluded from our knowledge systems of science and the practice of doing science. So, we are very slow in learning all the richness of science and technology embedded in nature. There are many, many different aspects. We don't have time to get into it. I taught a semester long course on biomimetic systems, processes, materials, philosophy, technologies, whatever, right? But just to give you some examples, now think about the fact that, you know, lotus leaf, water rolls down like mercury. So if we have the paint that mimics this, it's hugely valuable. Now you look at the colors in the nature, very vibrant. You cannot produce them with your run-of-the-mill paints, right? That's because it's a different technology. You look at this gecko and frogs and insects. They have what you may call reversible adhesion. But the tapes that we make for hanging posters, they are not reusable, right? So you use them once, you pull it out, and there it's gone. It's good for the company, but it's not good for the walls. It's not good for the poster. It's not good for your money, right? So if we can learn about how these guys do it, I mean, stick strongly, but keep moving, right? Then we have some great stuff there, both in terms of insight, new scientific insights, and also translation to technology. These are all the areas in which my group has worked at different times, and indeed I can assure you that it has very rich basic science in it, but also huge opportunities to translate that in terms of technology. So the point is, we see when we are doing our mundane everyday work in science, we must not lose sight of the larger questions. So we must always ask, what is the larger question in what I'm doing, right? Of course, I mean, I have to do day-to-day work to earn my fellowship and to publish papers and stuff like that. But I must devote 1 hour every day at least to relate it to other areas, other people, other things that are happening around me. And at the same time, keep track of why actually I'm doing this work. Having done all this, would I be able to relate it to a larger question? So I give you an example. There's actually an area in which my group and I, starting from PhD, worked for nearly 30 years. And I'll tell you where we went wrong and how we actually should have done it to begin with. Even though we published maybe 70 papers in the area, and some of these papers, maybe 10 of them were in physical review letters, which is considered to be a dignified journal in physics, whatever, right? But then, you know, you were not satisfied. You said, look, there's something missing in it, right? I'll tell you how that happens. So what is the larger question? The larger question is, we know about self-assembly. These molecules or small particles come together because of van der Waals or electrostatic interactions. They make bigger things, which may be useful, right? So this is called bottom-up way of fabricating things. Another concept, which is self-organization, which comes from physics. Right? The self-organization is things which are unstable, so they spontaneously change shape, right, to lower their energy. And this is a concept coming from physics. Now, typically, the length scale of objects that you make with assembly or self-assembly in chemistry, 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. What you make by self-organization in physics have typical length scales of 1 micron to 100 microns. So we kept thinking, what is the difference between the two? I mean, what is limiting the length scale of self-organization? And why do I need to think about it? Because if I can decrease the length scale of self-organized objects below 100 nanometers, then I can call it nanotechnology. If I call it nanotechnology, then you already know the answer. I can apply for funding to DST in nanomission, right? But if I don't do that, you know, if it's not below 100 nanometers, then it's not nanotechnology. And while there's not so much excitement, interest, and funding there. So I kept thinking about this particular issue. I'll give you the briefest background of the problem, even though this is a problem people have investigated for about 50 years now. And there would be as many groups around the world which have made contributions. So what are we going to look at here is a simple example of self-organization. The system we are looking at, you take a polymer solution and put a drop of it on a rotating disc. So because of centrifugal force, it spreads out like a thin film. The solvent evaporates, the polymer film is left there. A solid polymer film is left there. Now if I heat this film, heat it a little bit, or expose it to solvent vapor, it becomes liquid. And it's unstable, it starts breaking up spontaneously. So what you saw there was breakup of a initially smooth film, which is very thin. So its thickness may be 10 nanometers to 100 nanometers, 5 to 100 nanometers. And anyway, I'm not getting to rich physics of this problem, but what I want to say, look, it's breaking up in holes. These holes are growing up, they are coalescing, and they make some droplets on the surface. You can freeze these droplets by quenching the system to room temperature or removing the solvent, right? So you get this structure. So it's called symmetry breaking instability. If you want to be, you know, sound profound about it, you want to publish it, I say, here's another example of symmetry breaking instability, right? Okay, very good. Now, you see the distance between these drops and the size of these drops is not random. So this is what is called a spinodal process. People who work in, you know, physics, you know that this spinodal process, there are two different ways you can have change, even though it's taking us in a different direction, but might as well know. There are two different ways by which you can change something. So one of them is called the nucleation phenomena, which means you need a critical size of change before it can spread. Like discontent in the society, you need at least 100 people to be not very happy, then they will tell other people and it will spread. So this is called nucleation and growth. The other change which happens spontaneously, even by infinitesimal perturbation in the system, is the spinodal mechanism. The spinodal mechanism, there is always a length scale, meaning that this is not random, that, you know, I can change the scale of this structure by changing the thickness of the film and other things. So the length scale squared, lambda squared, is proportional to surface tension divided by destabilizing potential. Without getting into it, you know, I want you to focus on surface tension. So you say everything, you know, has a, every surface has a surface tension, which is the excess energy of the surface, right? And why it plays very important role in nanotechnology is because things are very small. If things are small, then surface to volume ratio is very large. Other words, it's all surface. There is no volume. When things get very small, it's the two-dimensional physics that controls, not the three-dimensional physics, right? So therefore, surface tension becomes very important. It's not gravity, it is not van der Waals, it's not, there's nothing. Surface tension becomes the one single important factor that controls the behavior. So now, if you see, why does it control? Because if you know, when you fragment a surface, you create more surface area. So somebody has to do work. More the surface tension, more work you have to do to create this extra surface, right? So now, coming back to the question, if you want to decrease the dimensions of this droplet, right, or the distance between the droplets, what you have to worry about is surface tension. But surface tension is a material property, so you can't really do very much about it, right? And so this is where the story was for 50 years. Okay, and of course, without getting into details, you can also create regular structures in polymers by doing this, by doing self-organization, which is very useful, and I'll not get into it, but very useful for making devices. For example, polymer-based devices, optoelectronic devices, sensors, or what have you. So let's go beyond. What we want to do is, you see in all of this, the size of structures is micron, right? Because it's controlled by surface tension, and we want to get rid of surface tension. So how do we do that? So these were the problems, that the size is large because of surface tension. Then also because you're doing processing of a fluid, you cannot get sharp corners in these structures. Again, because of what? Because same thing, surface tension. So, you know, because surface tension rounds up everything to decrease the surface area. So by doing this method, you cannot create, for example, droplets which are square. In many applications, you want these structures which are, let's say, created like they look like photolithography, or they look like whatever, you know, solid phase processing. So these were problems, and the solution actually was very simple. And it took us 30 years not only us, but everybody else, to say what the problem was and what the solution is. So solution actually is like this. You know, those of you who have seen movies from 1970s, there was this villain called Ajit, right? He was often going against either Amitabh Bachchan or Dharmendra, right? One of the two. So he would say, he would have a sidekick, usually called Jack Mack. So he'd say, hey, Jack, throw Dharmendra in liquid oxygen, right? And he'd say, because liquid usse jeene nahi dega, oxygen usse marne nahi dega, right? So we applied the same principle here, and I'll tell you how, right? We wrote a lot of papers which look like this, you know, these highly complex, nonlinear, eighth order equations that run into 40 pages and don't make anybody any wiser, right? I have to admit that, right? So you see, what goes in the equations is what comes out of them. Nothing new is ever going to come out of equations if the physics is not correct, right? So no matter where you publish them, no matter how many people appreciate it, it's only the people who wrote the paper know the weaknesses of that work, right? There's some joke about it. You say, you know, it's about theory and experiments. They say theory is something that everybody believes except the person who did it. And experiments are other way around. Or maybe the whole joke is other way around. I mean, you have to figure it out yourself, right? I say, you know, in one case, everybody believes it except the person who did it. In the other case, it's other way around, right? So the solution to this problem, if you think about it, how do you decrease surface tension? You see, by definition, if you put, let us say, a substance in a good solvent, then the substance dissolves in that solvent. There is no interface, right? So any substance in a good solvent has no interface and no interfacial tension by definition, right? So you think, well, if I take this polymer film and dip it in a good solvent, then surface tension should go to zero, which is good, except only problem is there would not be any polymer left to do anything with it, right? So you looked at one part of the solution, which is how to make surface tension zero. Now the second part of the problem is, but let the polymer live, okay, while doing this process. So now the second part of the puzzle is, well, you make a mixture of two liquids, one of which is a good solvent, the other is a non-solvent. Like for example, in this particular case, methyl ethyl ketone, some organic solvent mixed with water. Now you change the proportion of these two things in such a way so that the good solvent goes in the polymer, liquefies it and reduce surface tension to nearly zero. At the same time, polymer cannot dissolve because of the presence of this non-solvent like water, which is sitting in big quantity outside, right? So this is exactly the same thing I told you about the liquid oxygen, right? So in this case, the good solvent doesn't let it live. It fragments the film, reduces surface tension to zero. At the same time, the non-solvent water, it doesn't let it die. Other word, let it dissolve, right? So now, well, when you do that, you quickly see that you can reduce the length scale indeed below 100 nanometers. Lo and behold, you can indeed get some funding from Nanomission for this part. And also, interestingly, you see that the structures that develop now, they have sharp corners. So these are actually all liquid droplets before they are solidified. All these structures are made in liquid, right? And you see sharp corners here. It looks like a solid. And the reason is surface tension is nearly zero. So there is no rounding off of these structures. Anyway, what do we do? So next question you ask is, so using this technique, we could make an array of these tiny polymer domains, which are shown over here. So this is the basic science, right? Now, having done basic science, we must ask ourselves, okay, good, we got some insights. What do I do with it now, right? So if we leave the basic science and say, look, somebody else is going to do something with it, then I think that we are barking up the wrong tree. Because the person who has done the basic science has the most basic understanding of what he has done, she has done, and then what to do more with it.